sitting on that sofa, you have to take.
EastJet flight
EasyJet
26877 traveling to
Alex. Strange. Well, I wanted to be in Berlin roughly at the same time as the Russians, because it was obviously the German capital. And hence the reason the Americans and the British stay in Berlin, the Russians have got East Berlin plus all the surrounding countryside. So during the Cold War, we were deep in East German territory, but West Berlin was like an island in communism. And then hence the reason a lot of people, when they escaped, when they got from East Berlin into West Berlin, that was their free.
And now also a way to deal with such a heritage change. Imagine in the 1950s, in the Cold War, and probably at the time when the Soviet Union was not the most popular country in West Berlin, I'm not sure if they would have maintained these inscriptions. Today, it's different. It means so. Before, the memory of the Russians, they checked all.
Let me sport.
President of the Parliament at that time.
I'm sure I'm not going to get you every step you
take.
The Minister of Economy. On the right side, I'm one party, absolute majority. And the mask usually takes 4 or 5 days to clean it.
Slavic word, they've always been here. But the story begins really 600 years ago, because in the early 15th century, a load of German knights were told by the Pope, get up to northeastern Europe, there's nothing going on, just a load of Slavic pagans, I'll give it to you, let's call it the Mark Brandenburg. And during it to the Holy Land, that movement, Christians going east, took place in northern Europe as well. And these guys from Nuremberg would have ridden out the countryside, they find this village, they're like, so we the people look down on the politicians, a bit of a disaster, they're paying for 10 years. But now it's back, and around it you would have seen the new diplomatic quarter. So that's very symbolic, and it's one of the two huge building sites that did first, then they're coming for everything else. The other thing, big building site, went down a little bit of a different deal. So it's quite brave they actually built this thing in the first place. But they had to have a competition about to answer two questions. And this was designed by a bloke called Eisenman from New York, and it's genius. You stand here long enough and you listen to folks coming past, the most frequently asked question they're asking each other is, what is going?
Some people see train carriages, some people see barracks, some people see soldiers, some people see a city, some see a crowd of people, different ages and sizes, all milling about. And this little frequency as it goes up and down, the more you know, the more you can feel.
So you find out what it is, you wonder what it might be, you think about what it commemorates, and you walk through it. It's pretty weird, right? It's got a sort of disorientating feel. So we're going to wander through, and we're going to meet up on the other side in a few minutes, all right? If you go too far to the right, if you keep going to the right, you can't get out. It's an emergency exit fence. Okay, so use these avenues and we'll meet up in a few minutes on the other side.
It's kind of weird. It makes you feel a little bit like you're like, oh, wait a minute, right on a boat. I really like it. So, there's a lot of people that don't like it. People want information, the rationalists, if you like. But, as I said before, what language will it be and how do you present that? So I like the sort of emotional model. They want to deal with it on their own. This thing over here is an exhibition. That wasn't part of the proposal. They ducked under there.
So Adolf Hitler waving from the window the day he became Chancellor. That was in the Chancellor's Palace. And that old villa, now gone, is that where the building is here behind the site. Okay? Then he thought, it's not big enough, I want a proper Nazi building.
So York, right? Those things, the Twin Towers, the World Trade Centres. If you'd taken a World Trade Centre and...
Only had a 2 metre thick roof, and the rooftop came to the level of your feet. Okay? So in 1943, they built another one. And that's this, and they never completely finished it. It had a 4.5 metre thick roof. The tallest block in the memorial you just walked through is still 50 centimetres shorter than the thickness, just the thickness of the roof. All right, ridiculous. That's why it was very difficult to get rid of. But to get an idea of how it lay below the ground, you need to turn that picture through 90 degrees to the left, like that, right? City of Tells, look at their hands. They're all linked together. Now this is a demonstration, it's the truth of what East Germans really looked like 8 years after World War II, 1953. If you look above the picture, you can see a mural. Remember, let's go in there where it's a bit quieter, not tell you what. They're still wondering what they're going to do. Where did they take the ghettos in Poland? 1942, the train runs out. Concentration camps that go to tomorrow. Big horrible prisons, extermination camps. People were dead within 3 hours of arriving. He spent the rest of the day and night sorting their stuff, sending it back to Berlin and burning their bodies. Nightmare. I saw the town theatre, that's actually from 1819. But a little glimpse of Berlin during the Prussian phase. The name of the square is Gendarmenmarkt. And like police or armed men, literally. Berners had three immigrant groups. The James had to drain the land and build canals, international traders. They all come at the same time, 17th century. The Jews came because Berners became Berners' bankers, essentially. And the French turned up because they were Protestants and were being persecuted at home. So they came here, 5,000. So this is the empty library. And what it commemorates, like so many things in Berlin, is what's not there anymore. Right? Now, if you looked at that, as you look at it, you're all standing still, but as you look at it, you can't see it all in one go. Have you noticed that? You end up doing this. But that's part of the idea as well. When you look down, the first thing you see is nothing, because the books that were burned above ground have gone. Then you see your own reflection, deep. And then you look at the shelves and work it out, and you can't see it all in one glimpse, just like you'll never be able to fully comprehend what was lost. So here, a huge mound of books, about 23,000 were burned, not just here, but all over Germany, on the 10th of May 1933. And that's the Nazi propaganda ball rolling forward. Hitler's now Chancellor, end of January, and these are the views of the world you're no longer allowed to share. But he was Einstein, so he went to the States. His books were burned. Freud, Kafka, views of the world the Nazis disapproved of. They said it was illegal and un-German to own those books. They had three retro tracks over there. They filled them with books from all over the city. Bookshops, private collections, schools, university library. There's one channel there, that's the main channel. It's not exactly the Danube, but we like it. You've got that there. And behind, this is the marsh that named Berlin. It's the oldest part of the town. That marsh has now become like a canal. But it is a true island. Behind the building behind me that I'll tell you about in a minute, you can see it's still here. The other is gone. So if you look to the right, that entire space over there. At the moment, that blue thing, you can see to the right, that's an exhibition. Because, as you can see, the palace is gone. What happened to it? East Germany blew it up. Why? It represented a regime the communist East Germans didn't want to remember. The imperial family.
Basically, it's concentrating a population in a certain place, obviously a desired population in many circumstances. In the case of the Nazis, it was to put them to officially put people to work, benefit from slave labor. But of course, they were used to profile people, torture people, murder people as well. When we look at the Nazis, of course, there are two types of concentration camps, the Arbeitslager, the work camps, such as Sachsenhausen, and the extermination camp. In the extermination camp, people were murdered. The next time we saw a large influx of Jewish prisoners at Sachsenhausen was 1945, with the end of the war on its way. The Soviets gaining a great deal of land east of here. Other camps had to be evacuated, closed, destroyed, and that's when we see women and children arriving at Sachsenhausen as well. For me, you know, this is East Germany. East Germany saw an abuse of authority, of course, all the way up until 1990. So I think that it's actually quite a good kind of lesson, in a way, to have these next pictures. Even this time last year, this thing was still a wreck. It's going to be turned into a museum soon. So the SS, they're working inside the concentration camp every day. It's their job to, you know, murder, intimidate, torture people. And this is where they would go to relax. They would be served, you know, warm food, lovely big meals by the prisoners themselves. So, why would the prisoners do this? Who was doing this? They had to have specific kinds of prisoners inside of here, which were Jehovah's Witnesses. Because of what they believed, they would be trusted to never attack the guards, poison the guards. They could even be trusted not to steal this food. They're being systematically starved, but if they steal any food, they're going to be punished, or other people are going to be punished brutally because of their actions. The Jehovah's Witnesses could actually be so manipulated by the guards that they would be sent into Oranienburg to run errands, and they would still return to the concentration camp in the evening. A lot of people didn't really know what was going to happen when they arrived at the concentration camps. The Nazis had taken pretty much complete control of the press by 1935, so the truth about these places, about people being starved, about torture and so on, really wasn't coming out. 1936 prisoners being brought here then would be wearing their own clothes, carrying a suitcase full of their own belongings.
When they get through those gates, things change pretty fast. This is the neutral zone, and you will be shot and killed for escaping. Now, going back again to the first time I came here, I was on a tour with a colleague of mine. And what went through my head immediately isn't exactly the thing I'm most proud of, but I thought, why wouldn't prisoners do this? If this is their lives, which I just explained, every day, they're being starved, they're being put to work, they're going through this horrible roll call, surely a lot of prisoners would have seen this as a way to escape this, to commit suicide.
Okay, so...
Sure. But the way that the Nazis dealt with this was kind of what we were talking about.
Wait, where did it go?
Communists have done the Soviet returned to our part of Germany. They got rid of all the fascists, none of them survived. Obviously not true, but that's what they said. So, after reunification, everything had to be changed somewhat.
Because these ideas of race are entirely socially imposed, there's an entirely psychological vision. There was no science behind it whatsoever. Because of this, people needed to be told by the Nazis essentially what the Nazis believed. These posters, leaflets, so on were incredibly effective that way. I'm sure it would. So sorry about that. Are there any other questions?
Considering the immoral orders all just to ISIS, but like what ones would have stayed at Sachsenhausen?
Anyone that would have stayed at Sachsenhausen kept in the park before they were sent to two other concentration camps. After the order of all Jewish people heading to total number murdered at Auschwitz, this is not just Jewish people, this is everyone, all the groups that we've talked about. The agreed historical figure today is roughly 1.5 million. 6 million Jewish people killed in total. So the idea was that they were sent there to be killed, but it wasn't a policy that ever worked in practice. People didn't really know what went on inside here. A lot of the guards that worked here wouldn't have known either. The prison camp was not run exclusively by the SS. It was also run by the Gestapo, or the Geheimstaatspolizei, which means secret state police. These are the people that have information. They can give to the prisoners themselves, tell them how well the war is going, tell them about the Battle of Stalingrad, tell them about D-Day, of the Nazis, to give the prisoners any sort of hope whatsoever. Prisoners inside of here were tortured in a number of whatsoever, so people didn't really know what time of day it was, the time of year it was, and so on. Prisoners were also isolated, so they had no human contact whatsoever other than some food being pushed through a hole in their door. A lot of prisoners, though, were also tortured physically. And one of the ways that took place was in a concrete chamber which is beneath our feet. If you look at this is a model here. So the entrance is this little thing behind you. I know it looks really strange, but that would have been here. And there's this room inside of here, this concrete room, which is incredibly cold in the winter and incredibly warm in the summer. Prisoners are tortured by being exposed to these temperatures for hours at a time. Of course, weather not always reliable. So prisoners were murdered in here. A prison where the prisoners could be watched at any time, but don't know if they're being watched at any time. So that you actually see the cells, and you can see The hanging pole's done, that's done behind me. As I said before, they were used to torture prisoners physically. So they weren't used specifically to kill prisoners. Prisoners were not hanged. They were not dropped and had their necks broken or left here to choke or anything like that. It was very, very sadistic what happened here. Prisoners had their arms tied behind their backs, like this, and then sometimes they were dropped onto the pole, or sometimes they were lifted onto the pole and simply hung there for hours. What this would do, hanging prisoners by their arms in this way, would slowly take their arms out of their sockets, which of course was incredibly painful. People would scream in pain. Screams carry out over these walls. People in the camp can hear it. They know that something horrible is happening, but they don't know what. There's this idea of the unknown, which would then make this prison inside of here notorious and make sure that the general population of the camp do not want to give themselves any reason to end up inside of here.
Finally, some of the people must be new or what? Okay, I'll show some of them. Past the Nemo, right? Now, I don't know if you can make anything, but I know we got written. And Nemo was actually, he was the commander in the First World War of a German U-boat. Okay, and then after the First World War, he actually joins the church. And he's arrested and brought here as a prisoner. And Nemo, I'm trying to remember, actually survives the war. And he writes a very famous poem called Here Stand I. Now, unfortunately, I don't remember all the words of it, but the gist is he talks about first the came for the communists, and I didn't say anything because I wasn't a communist, and then they came for the socialists, and I didn't say anything because I was not a socialist, and then I think they're different groups, and then they came for the Jews, and I didn't say anything because I was not a Jew, and he finishes, of course, by saying, and finally they came for me, and there was no one there to say anything for me. Very famous thing, and Nemo survived, and a brave man. Okay, so he's kept here now. I think
because he's a social.
He was a church minister.
Oh.
He was a Protestant minister in the southwest of Berlin, in a district called Dahlem. And when the Nazis came to power, there wasn't actually a great deal of opposition from the church, as would have been expected, because in the Weimar Republic there was a lot of excess, there's a lot of adultery, drugs, cabaret and so on. So the church kind of appreciated to an extent that things were, that socially life was being cleaned up in a way. Of course, the Nazis, who could really abide by them, but it was easier to do nothing, right? This is what his poem was about. So he stood up as one of very few clerics to actually say in church, every week, we have to do something about this terrible power that has taken control. That's why he made himself a political prisoner in the eyes of the Nazis.
He's
a movie that came out about them a few years ago, I think it was 2007, I'm not sure. It's a German film, it's called The Counterfeiters. If you get an opportunity to watch The Counterfeiters, I really recommend it. It's a really, really very interesting movie. The movie itself is, if you look around, you can see the next one is a different kind of gravel, and then another, and then another, and then another, leading all the way around the front of the barracks, around the roll call yard. Boot testing track is actually a fairly poor translation. There isn't really an exact translation here. The prisoners were not testing boots, but they were testing a sole that could be attached to shoes that would be very, very useful for the German army. Two companies could produce this, so the Nazi government decided that in order to test them fairly, they would test them at the concentration camp. So they had prisoners running around here 12 hours per day. They did get a break for food in the middle. And they did this, but this wasn't test enough. They've been doing it for 4 years, but they needed to up the ante, as it were. So they had prisoners carrying heavy bags of sand, sometimes as heavy as 20 kilos. Because of this, prisoners were given more breaks during the day, but these were what were called exercise breaks. So during these so-called exercise breaks, was 12 days. 12 days after arriving at this camp, if you're given this work detail, the likelihood is that you are going to be dead. This work detail, there is no reason for this, no reason that the Nazis ever gave. This work detail was mostly given to homosexual prisoners. There was another work detail for the prisoners, for some of the prisoners. The flowers that you see here, the ones that are in this style, were done by one of the prisoners. This is probably the most likely. It's that one of the guards supplied one of the prisoners, not just with paint, okay, but with also free time to express himself to escape somewhat, okay, from the realities of this horrible place. There were, I guess, events of what we would call this was part of the deal, so we don't know all about.
These ones are from the period that have been part of all the time before the Brexit, and everyone would like to use a chance on the mic, and they're all allowed to be killed, essentially, if they don't have all sides.
Our structure that stands behind me, it's actually a place to have been divided into two countries for 12 years. So this was East Germany, okay, all three of these were in East Germany. When this place was opened, an audience of 200,000 people were brought here to fill out the site and to proclaim a communist. As they were being led down here, the prisoners knew what was happening, so they would start to fight back. It was a lengthy process somewhat. The guards complained that it was very difficult to look someone in the eye before killing them. They're being shot at very close range, it caused a lot of mess for a very long time to clear up. When the prisoners had been shot, their bodies were stored in the room to your right, just over here, until the room was full. They were then loaded up onto trucks and taken to various crematoria in Berlin. Now, the Nazis were keeping the realities of these. So, prisoners were led in one way and kind of went around this fake medical institution. The best way to really show you this is to walk around the outside.
We actually call up 25 bodies having ashes to family members, like your brother, your husband, whatever.